Good morning, good morning, and happy Saturday to you, cartoon crew. Here we are. We're doing Saturday Morning Cartoons, a show that we do mostly every Saturday at 9 a.m. And I am here today with my co-host. Looks like one moment. We've got Mr. Mark B. Leon. Hey!
Hey guys, good morning, Rose. How you doing?
Hey, good, thanks. So tell us what you're doing today.
I am in a 95-minute long line for Rise of the Resistance here in Galaxy's Edge. If I can turn the camera around, if I know how to do that, I'll show you where I am. Let me see. I don't know how to turn the camera around. This is so stupid. Stand by. I'll do this.
That is incredible. Look at all these people.
Yeah, so we're about...
Have you been on this before?
I've been on the first one, which was the Millennium Falcon ride, but I've never been on Rise. I was here when Galaxy Edge opened. I got an employee invite. So we were here before it was open to the public. Rise of the Resistance had not been finished as of yet. I am here today with my friend. Say hi, Martina. Martina's here from Germany, and she wanted to see it. Oh, are you still there, Rose?
Yeah.
Are you? I think I lost Rose.
Oh.
Oh, I'm sorry. I don't see you. I just see me. Oh, I see you. Full screen me. Don't do that. Nobody wants to see me. Hey, where's Jerome? Where's Jerome?
There's Jerome Carter. Ah, there.
Good morning. Good morning.
95-minute wait. Rise of the Resistance. We're walking through the line as I speak.
What's the weather like up there today?
Oh, it is very, very foggy, but it's going to be a high of around, I think, maybe 82, 83 today and sunny. So once we get rid of this fog, it's going to be a beautiful day.
Have a great time.
I don't know how to. Oops, sorry about that. I wish I knew how to turn this camera around so I can at least show you guys where I'm going.
Well, you can physically turn it.
Well, I did that before you came on. I'm about to do this. Hey, Mike, I'm about to do this now. Here we go.
Yep, a typical day in Disney.
Yeah, Terry's asking if you made a lightsaber yet.
Hey, I wanted to go to Walmart. You know, I mean, why the hell am I at Disney? I could be at Walmart today.
It's just as much amusement at Walmart, you know, perhaps, but it's a little more scary.
You know what? Same kind of people, too.
Yeah.
But other than that, you guys, just wanted to pop in and say hi. You guys have a great show this morning. Look what I'm wearing, of course.
Of course.
Excellent. Already got numerous comments from the elder generation on how fantastic of a shirt I'm wearing.
Yeah, tell them about our show.
All right. So, I see Joe just said Rise of the Resistance is worth the 95-minute wait. That's fantastic. We'll probably do Star Wars, then pop over to Animal Kingdom and probably go to Walmart.
We expect a full report next week, Mark.
I'm sorry. I got stormtroopers blasting in my ear right now. Shut up, metalheads. Bucketheads. All right, guys. You have a good show this morning. All right. Bye. Take care.
Bye.
Bye-bye. How do I get off this damn thing? Oh, there.
You know, we got to warn Mike. We got to warn Mark about the thing called a hot mic. Oh, that is funny.
So I hope that Mark has a great day, and we've got a show for you today. But before we do that, we usually do our morning garbage. So, Jerome, what's been going on with you? Anything new?
Nah, nothing new. You know, we're just getting ready for the holidays. Decided, you know, what we're going to do for Thanksgiving, working on Christmas now, you know, because quite frankly, I hate the malls during Christmas, having worked in some.
Well, that's why people use Amazon.
Oh, don't you dare. Don't you dare. For those that don't know, I work at an Amazon facility, and Black Friday is the beginning of what they call peak. We can't take any time off, can't take any vacation. We actually have to work extra hours, and we look at some of the stuff that comes through here. You can see the labels. You know, sometimes they'll just slap a label, a shipping label on something that somebody's ordered, and you look at it and you're going, you couldn't go down to the grocery store and get this. You know, bottles of dish soap or diapers. And you just kind of go in grocery store, especially in New England. There's like, you can't swing a dead cat without hitting a grocery store.
Well, yeah, we have like five or six here, but you know what I've been doing? I've been ordering from Walmart and having them drop off like the heavy stuff because I'm just like, why should I lug all that stuff around when I can pay somebody $10 to come deliver it to my house? So there's the thinking, Jerome. People don't want to. People are doing.
Don't want to leave their house. Don't want to leave their house. That's what it comes down to.
Yes. You know, so that's it. So
that's pretty much it for me.
Well,
what about you?
It doesn't even feel like it does. It didn't feel October came and went. I didn't feel like that's my favorite month, and I totally missed it. I felt like the only thing I got to do fun was go to Spooky Empire Convention, which was a lot of fun. But other than that, it was gone. And here we are. It's almost the middle of November.
I know. 2 weeks.
It doesn't even feel like it to me.
2 weeks is Bird Day.
And I'm not even, we don't usually do a lot for Thanksgiving. We either go out of town or we have something small at the house. And I think that's going to be one of those small at the house type of years. But, you know, I wanted to do something special and like at least order in because my cooking is not the greatest. So I need to get around and get my order in because time is flying by.
Yeah.
And speaking about time flying by, you know, it's hard when you see your childhood heroes fading off into, you know, the next chapter, you know, beyond.
Oh, I know.
You know, and we've lost a couple of people yesterday. And we talked about it last night on Classic Television SmackDown, but Jerome, why don't you go ahead and fill us in? Because a lot of people weren't on the show last night. We got a different audience here.
Well, last night we talked about, all right, so I'll talk about the first one that's not as big for this audience, which was the comedian Gallagher from the 1980s, known for his sledge-o-matic, which was breaking watermelons on stage with a big sledgehammer. At the age of 76, he had passed away yesterday. His comedy was what they call prop comedy. And he was basically an iconic 80s comedian. You know, when you think of the 80s and the HBO specials, that was the man that a lot of people thought of, because of all the specials he had. But the one that affects this crew more than anything else is the sudden passing of Kevin Conway. Known to this crew as the voice of Batman on the animated series Justice League and a whole series of DC animated films. Unfortunately, we didn't know this until he passed, that he was suffering from cancer, and that is what made him pass. I am sad to say that I missed meeting him up here in September due to some financial and work issues, which now that this has happened, I even more regret it. But he basically defined the voice of Batman for almost 30 years.
Yeah.
And I think next week we're going to try to do a retrospect on him. I got to see what I can pull together in a few days. That's kind of where we're going to go with this. And, but it just, you know, it's a sad day for the cartoon world. Mark Hamill, you know, basically said he felt like he lost a brother. I had a chance to meet And guys, and the crew, you're gonna have to help me. The guy who did the voice of Terry in Batman Beyond, I had a chance to meet him, and I told him how much I enjoyed the work they did on Return of the Joker. Yes, we did, and that was on Crisis on Infinite Earths, Arrowverse series. Terry, he told me basically that he sat between Mark Hamill and Kevin Conroy for 10 days, and the two of them took him under his wing and just taught him so much. And he said the graciousness of Kevin Conroy was absolutely amazing to him. So we're going to do a little bit of Kevin Conroy retrospective next week. Thank you, Will Fidel. Thank you, Joe. So that's where we lost over this weekend, but we're going to try to, you know, have a happier note next weekend and talk about all the great things he did. So we're going to do like a New Orleans thing. You know, we're going to celebrate his life, not mourn his death, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Yep. And today that goes into what we're doing today. A couple of weeks ago, we lost a pioneer in the world of animation and stop motion animation, and that was Jules Bass.
Yep.
Jules Bass. He was born September 16th, 1935, and he passed away on October 25th. He was known for his Mostly, if you think of Rankin and Bass, what you think about are like a lot of the Christmas specials that you had in your childhood in the 70s and 60s.
Yep.
Santa Claus is Coming to Town, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, and many more. But I really didn't want to focus on the Christmas stuff today because we'll probably be having a Christmas show that highlights a lot of those. So I only put one Christmas special on today to discuss. But also I wanted to talk about a lot of his other shows and a lot of stuff that they did throughout the decades. Jules Bass was born in Philadelphia, and he almost passed away of scarlet fever when he was a teenager.
Wow.
He ended up attending New York University, and he started off in the advertising field, and later on started working with Arthur Rankin Jr. At ABC, the American Broadcasting Company, mm-hmm. in 1955.
Yep.
He was the art director and a copywriter, and they ended up making commercials and moved on to establish a company called Videocraft International in 1960. And then they released their first syndicated television series, and The New Adventures of Pinocchio, that same year. And I did not see The New Adventures of Pinocchio ever, but how about you, Jerome? Do you remember that show at all?
No, actually, I've heard of it, but I don't ever recall seeing it. You know, I had heard of it, but I, to be honest, for the longest time until I saw a bizarre sci-fi film about Pinocchio, I'd always thought Pinocchio was just that Disney film.
Right. I mean, the thing is, that the show is originally, I think, from Italian story called Ponchiletto or something like
that. Something like that. Yeah.
Yeah. But, you know, it's basically the story about a wooden puppet made by a gentleman named Geppetto. And he, you know, ends up wanting to aspire to be a real boy. And this has been made time and time again. There's like tons of different stories. One just came out. I didn't see it, the Disney one. And then there's another one coming out by Guillermo del Toro, which should be interesting.
Oh, yeah, that's going to be dark and ugly.
it's always kind of creepy stuff comes from him. But I guess they've been working on this for a decade, and it's coming out on Netflix, I guess.
That's going to be interesting.
But, yeah, so Rankin and Bass, you know, took this story and made it their own. Their first show, The New Adventures of Pinocchio, and basically Pinocchio goes off, leaves his father, Geppetto, and he goes off with the cricket to find the blue fairy to try to become a real boy. That's the new adventure. So I'm going to show a clip from that. This is stop motion animation from 1960.
Okay.
I say, old man, haven't we met before? Rome? Paris? Bangkok? The Bronx Zoo? Penknife? No. Staten Island?
Gee, I'm afraid I don't know either of you.
Apple Core? No. The Riviera? Gold Watch? Gold Watch? That's mine, you see? Hey, wait for us!
So, you know, I thought that was interesting. They got a lot better, I think, as they went on throughout the years. Yeah. But that was just a taste of their small animation stop motion. They did actually 135 minute chapters in syndication for this show.
Wow.
And that's a lot. And it went on, and it was only on for a year. You know how these things go. Back then, they worked these people to death.
Literally.
But that's it. I don't know if anybody in the cartoon crew ever saw that show. I mean, I would have thought that as a child, because they used to run all this stuff, you know, ad nauseum in reruns, that I would have seen this at one point, but I never came across the show.
Yeah.
But that was the first Rankin Bass show. And then later on in 1967, they did a Christmas special for NBC. Called Cricket on the Hearth. Does that sound familiar to you?
Nope. Don't know that one either.
Now, this one's gotten some airtime, and I think I vaguely recall seeing it as a kid. It's based actually on a Charles Dickens story, which I did not know.
Really?
And I guess it's about this cricket who comes into these people's lives and you know, makes things better for them. But I am going to show a clip. Mike, you never saw the Pinocchio one?
Whoa.
So that's how obscure it is. If Mike hasn't seen it, yeah, you know, you wonder if it even existed. But here is Cricket on the Hearth. It has played on Freeform, and it's been on video. So here we go. We're going to show a clip of that.
How about staying with us for a while? Come on now. Just go inside and make yourself at home. If you've a mind to.
Oh,
it's not a very exciting place, just me and my daughter and of course, the toys.
Sir, I'd be delighted. Crockett's the name. Cricket Crockett.
I'm Caleb Plummer. We'll work out the arrangements later, after I deliver these toys. Ta-ta.
I suppose I had never seen a happier room. And there, in the corner, was the nicest little hearth you could ever hope for.
That sounded like Roddy McDowell.
It might have been. I did not check on that. But,
yeah, I'll look it up. It's Cricket
the
on the
what? The funny thing is about Cricket on the Hearth, Mike makes a really interesting comment here. He said that he saw one with Marlo Thomas as the voice. And that's very interesting because Cricket on the Hearth originally aired on a Danny Thomas show.
Yep. And she was indeed Bertha. Cricket was Roddy McDowell.
Yeah.
Let me see if I can find the rest of it here. It's on IMDb.
You have a good ear there, Jerome.
Yeah. Well, you know, you kind of pick up on certain people. Let's see here. Come on, Topcast. Here we go. Danny Thomas was himself. Ed Ames. Roddy McDowell. Paul Frees was the messenger. So, yeah. So, there's a lot of... Yeah.
Okay. So, yes. Yeah, so, it aired in 1967. It was the 12th episode of the Danny Thomas Hour.
Yep.
So, very interesting. I don't know if the new... Like, Danny... Like, the one I pulled from, Danny Thomas actually introduces the whole thing.
Yep.
But I don't know if that's like on the video or how they air it on TV. I don't know. They probably cut that part out, I would think. A lot of people don't even know who Danny Thomas is anymore. But yes. So, he says Danny Thomas
is a voice too. Yeah, that's what I was saying. He's the messenger.
Yeah. So,
or he was a voice on there, whatever. Yeah, you're right. He did the introduction.
So, yeah, I vaguely recall this one growing up, and it still kicks around, I think, at holiday time. So if you haven't seen it, you might want to check it out. Let's see. So, you know what? Out of all the Christmas specials, I picked the one that is probably Mark's favorite, and he's not here to enjoy it.
That's so, serving right. You know, that'll but serve him.
We'll go ahead and show it anyway. It is The Little Drummer Boy. This was a production that came on. It was first televised in Canada in 1968. And then it had, 4 days later, it was on NBC here in 1968 as well. Now, this show I've seen. This is one they play, they used to play every year at Christmas time. It's so, you know, you want to cry when that little lamb dies or almost dies. And so, oh, look, let's see. He has that little drummer boy on DVD. Yes. Yeah, it's a classic and I think Mark's favorite. So we'll go ahead and play this clip.
Yes, the kings are wise. They will be able to save Baba.
You must let me through!
And when Aaron came to the entrance of the stable, he could hardly believe what he saw. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
Oh, your majesty! You must...
Oh, the player boy.
My lamb has been injured. You must save him.
He is near death. Oh, lad, there is nothing I can do.
But you are a king!
A mortal king only. But there is a king among kings who would save your little friend.
The babe? But I do not understand.
It is not necessary that you understand. Go to him.
I have no gift to bring.
Go. Look upon the newborn king.
And we cut it before the music starts. Bum bum bum.
Yeah, then it gets a little fun, you know.
So yeah, so this is another stop motion animation. You know, it's widely renowned, played every year. I think it got some awards back in the time.
Yeah.
I love stop motion. I mean, It's a dying art, the stop motion, you know?
Yeah.
You're dead, you know? But, you know, because everything now is, you know, CGI. And you know, it's just like, why put all that time and effort into something when you can just, you know, put pixels on a computer?
Yeah. Paul Frees was in this one. And I think you just heard Paul Frees talking to the kid. Jose Ferrer was in this also. And, of course, singing the title song was the Vienna Boys Choir.
Yes.
So, again, a lot of really good voices.
Yes, a super classic that one is. And sorry, Mark, you missed it. That was just for you. I am sure we'll probably see it again sometime this holiday, most likely.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
So the next up is a show I did not know existed, and after watching some of the episodes that I watched, I know why now. I never saw it, and that is the Smokey Bear Show. Now everybody knows who Smokey Bear is. You know, only you can prevent forest fires. But way back when, there was a Dale came out with a series of comic books, and they decided to take these comic books and try to make a show out of them called The Smokey Bear Show. It aired in 1969 for one season. It's, you know, basically Smokey Bear is just trying to help these buffoons that live in this town who do some really crazy things. So I've got that clip and we'll run it, and then we can talk about it on the other side. And then I was able to put four of these in. And so just a heads up, everybody, there might, on the rest of these clips, there's probably going to be a slight drag or delay because I can only load up so many this way. So let's run this one, though. Come on.
got slow reactions.
What's all this about somebody's sister?
Not sister, Twister.
Man, I don't dig the twist no more since it went square.
It's almost here!
Get to the storm cellar! Don't have no storm cellar!
We'll grab some pails and shovels and dig one!
They live in the flatlands and have no shelter, okay?
Yeah.
Now, what is... Come on!
In the middle of the street, no less.
Exactly.
What's going on here?
Just a lot of noise and confusion. What do we do? It's here!
I always say, when in doubt, run for the hills!
So, yeah, so that's an interesting bunch of characters, and a lot of the episodes are similar to that, and the only one who has his wits about him usually is Smokey Bear to come do the deal. But, yeah, so it didn't translate well. People thought that the animation was kind of kooky. It was. And so it just didn't translate, and nobody liked it. So it went away after 17 episodes, and even though it played in reruns from 1969 to 1970, I think after that it must have disappeared into the ether because I never saw this show.
I caught an episode or two, because one of the things that people keep forgetting is that back in the 70s and into, say, the early 80s, a lot of these shows that were Saturday mornings were put on either Sunday morning or around the after-school time on your local independent stations, which were usually a UHF channel, okay? And you would see all these shows that you couldn't see in the original airing back in the 50s and 60s because they were being run on these independent stations as filler, okay? And so...
I don't know, Joe.
I think it might be the other way around. But anyway... Yeah, so a lot of these shows that I know I caught that were from that era, especially the early 60s, were either on reruns like Johnny Quest, which was brought back in the 70s, or they were thrown on some independent TV station that they were using filler for Sunday morning or after school time frame before the anime started showing up.
Yeah, and I absolutely don't remember it at all. So, but that's the Smokey Bear show. I'm surprised they never tried it again, because Smokey Bear's still around. You know, you still see these commercials from time to time. But, you know, who knows?
Yeah.
So we'll go on to the next one, which is another show that I am not familiar with at all. It's called The Reluctant Dragon and Mr. Toad Show. Came out in 1970 on ABC's Sunday morning schedule. And, I thought I had something, but there's the Reluctant Dragon. So it's like a split show. It's like part his show, the Reluctant Dragon, and then part Mr. Toad there. And I have a clip, so bear with me for a minute, and then we'll talk about it on the other side.
Okay.
So.
Frightened of 10 o'clock, Your Majesty.
Oh, I'm scared of everything nowadays. Why, only this morning when I appeared on the balcony.
Yeah.
They called me a sissy.
Your Majesty, there's only one way to stop this. Your people must see you do something brave and heroic. Ah, I have it. You can fight Tobias.
The dragon? He's the reason I'm so upset in the first place.
We'll stage the fight so it looks as though you win. You'll be a hero, I promise.
I loathe violence.
Blast it, Tobias. This won't be a real fight. It will be more like a play. Now, you always wanted to be an actor, didn't you?
To be or not to be.
You'll be perfect.
So, you know that, so
go ahead. I was gonna say that king is ripe for a coup.
Yes, he sure is. That is so silly. Well, the show was not to be. It lasted one season and 17 episodes. It was considered a flop.
Yeah, I can see why.
Midway through, yeah. The Mr. Toad part was based on Mr. Toad from The Wind in the Willows, which we'll get back to in a little bit. But, yeah, so that show just did not do well. You say you saw it.
Yeah. Yeah, I did. I remember watching the Mr. Toad part. I don't remember the dragon, but I saw the Mr. Toad a couple of episodes and immediately went to something else, to be honest. Okay. I watched a couple of episodes and then I don't know if like Scooby was on or something else was on, but I know immediately switched over to something else.
Yeah. So that was the forgettable dragon and Mr. Toad. But, yeah. So, they had a lot of successful shows later on, mostly their Christmas specials. But in 1972, they used to have, for kids, the Saturday Superstar Movie. And yep. One of the films that they showed was Mad, Mad, Mad Monsters, which was produced by Rankin and Bass. Basically, it was related somewhat to their stop-motion animated film earlier called Mad Monster Party. But this is they did this in the animated style. And basically it's about this guy, Harry von Frankenstein, creates a bride monster for his other monster. And Igor gets jealous and wants to have her as his girlfriend and, for himself. So basically that's the setup for Mad, Mad, Mad Monster Party. And we will... yeah, there we go. We got some interesting characters here. But we'll go ahead and play the clip here in just a minute. And there is a little lag, so just bear with us here.
Mm-hmm. Igor, raise the platform. Lower the platform, Igor. Igor, close the trap door. Igor, where are you?
Here, master.
Listen, Igor. I've done it, Igor. I created life again. The fools said it couldn't be done. I have accomplished the impossible twice. I've taken the cosmic forces out of nature.
Dead, no more old speech, master. See, girl.
Do you suppose I left her in the lightning too long?
Girl for Igor. Yeah, girl for Igor.
No, Igor, my friend. This monstrous is for the monster. He's getting to be a big boy now, and it's time he settled down. Ah, yes. She is a beauty, all right.
So I think this looks really cute. I never saw it, but it looks so cute.
Okay, so the Saturday morning movie thing there, the Saturday morning superstar movies, aired late in the morning, usually around the 12 to 12:30 time frame. Okay, so
by the time that they came on, most of us were already out the door.
Right.
Onto something else. And I remember a couple of them vividly. I remember one of them we sat with my folks and watched one, simply because it was based off of That Girl, the Marlo Thomas series. My dad liked that one and the one about the Red Baron. But this one, I don't remember, to be honest. But I do look at that, and it's very representative of the 70s. And it does look like it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, I would have liked to have seen this one. I think this one would, you know, still be good at come around, Halloween time.
Yeah,
It looks like a lot of fun. Has a bit of humor to it. So I let the clip play a little bit longer. So, so that came out in 1972. I don't know if it was ever out on video. Mike, did you ever see this one? Anybody in the cartoon crew ever see Mad Monsters? Let us know. And we're going to move on to another anthology series that they did for syndication, Rankin and Bass. And that's the Festival of Family Classics. It aired between 1972 and 1973. It was in syndication and played on Boomerang again in 2005 and in 2011 on the Teletoon Retro Network, which I've never heard of. There were 20 episodes in total, and basically they did a bunch of different stories, including Tom Sawyer, Robinson Crusoe, Around the World in 80 Days. And I have a couple of them that I'm going to show you. I was really hoping to find Robinson Crusoe, but I couldn't. So the first one that we're going to have is Puss in Boots. Very, very interesting story. I don't remember the story the way that this story is told. I think people put on different variations for these ones. But I'm going to go ahead and play the clip, and then we'll talk about it. So let me get to that.
It's in there somewhere.
It's the King and the Princess Melanie.
Don't bother with you, Melanie, dear. She's only a poor peasant.
Did you see her? She's the most beautiful girl I've ever seen. I wish I were a prince instead of a pauper. The princess threw me a flower. Me. And the king wouldn't let her talk to me. I wonder what else can happen, Tabby.
Looks like someone down there could use a bootmaker.
Looks like somebody's been out.
Yes, indeed. me. Magic boots, get your magic boots right here. Boots for wishing, boots for betting, magic boots for all occasions. Maybe he doesn't hear too well. I'll try again. Special sale on magic boots. You look as though you could use my services, young fella. Come on over here. Tell you what I'm going to do for you. I was beginning to think I'd lost my touch.
Are your boots very expensive?
Certainly not, for the money. Besides, whoever wears my boots will have wisdom, pluck, and luck.
Wisdom, pluck, and luck, huh? We could use all of that, couldn't we?
That's right. At least two out of three, anyway.
Well, ironically, you know, this guy doesn't get his new boots. The boots go to the cat, you know?
Yeah.
So the whole thing, this basic whole story on this version of Puss in Boots is that the cat gets all dressed up and tries to get the king to allow him to fall in love with the princess. So
have you ever noticed in these stories, in these animations, especially with Baskin and Rankin and the whole crew, that the supposedly gorgeous women in these are always blonde?
You know what? You know? I had never noticed that.
Oh yeah, yeah. You look at all the Christmas specials, all like the Santa Claus Comes to Town, blonde. Every woman that's there that the main character falls in love with, always blonde. I don't know if you've noticed that.
I think that was the assertion
yeah,
there.
Yeah.
Second, you know, either that or he's been out in the sun.
I think he's been out in the sun too long because his hands were all, his arms and hands were also red too.
But yeah, you know, I never noticed that the blonde thing. So that's a good observation. And Mike said he never saw the monsters.
Yep.
Party
My
show.
God, I can't believe that.
So. So yeah, so that is one of the stories that they did. They also did some the American classic tales for this special. One of them being Paul Bunyan, and I have a clip from Paul.
Oh, Paul Bunyan and his big blue ox babe.
Ox, and this one is kind of it's Rankin Bass style, as you.
Yep. I love the Paul Bunyan stories. Babe would lay down in a hole and people would think it was a lake.
Paul Bunyan, there's a job to do. Paul Bunyan, there's a special place for you. And suddenly the heavens shook and the thunder it roared and a star fell at Paul's feet. And then lightning struck the star and the rain began to fall and the earth smelled fresh and sweet. And Paul Bunyan looked down and he saw at his feet an axe head still glowing from the lightning bolt's heat. And then Bunyan knew what his life's work would be. And for an axe handle, he cut down a big oak tree. And then the mighty Bunyan knew what he was meant to be.
He's gonna be the king of the lumbermen, he is!
He cut down an oak tree. No, he pulled it up by its roots. Come on, folks.
So that was also part of their Festival of Family Classics. Like I said, there was 20 of these made. They've made their way through. I'm probably assume that some of these have been seen more than others throughout the years, and some of them were probably very forgettable.
Yeah.
I don't remember seeing Paul Bunyan at all. The Puss in Boots one's vaguely familiar to me. What about you, Jerome? Did you see any of these?
Don't remember any of this, that one, at all. 72, I'm trying to think, where was I? I was in New Hampshire. Yeah, I don't remember any of this, you know?
Yeah. I don't either, but they've been around. They've made the rounds. So, over the years, they produce so much, and there's only so much time to show, a lot of these. And like I said, I didn't want to show a whole bunch of the Christmas specials. But the next one that I have is actually the last production that they worked on. And it's not the last clip because I couldn't do the show without showing this one that they're very well known for. But I wanted to talk about the last show that they worked on first. And that is The Wind in the Willows, which is based on the book, children's book. And it was made in 1987. It was an animated musical made for television. And that was their last production that they did. And it aired in the UK first, and then it took a long time, but they finally aired it in 1987 on ABC. And, you know, the thing is that when you look at it, it's, I don't know, it seems like much like their regular productions. I mean, I was like thinking that this was like 70s style. And to see that it aired like almost a decade later, you know, I don't know. Did you ever see The Wind in the Willows?
No.
I mean, there's been so many versions of it.
No.
But I'm going to play a clip and hopefully, you know, we won't get hit for it because it is a musical and I tried to edit it as best I could from the clip that I had. So bear with me just 1 minute. We'll get that up.
Whereas and wherefore hereafter and however, the prisoner is accused of maliciously and with malice aforethought stealing a contraption.
What?
The prisoner has the benefit of the doubt when there is a doubt. In this case, there isn't any doubt in it.
No doubt! Guilty!
Not a plausible defense, nor a frank apology, not a crumb of true contrition have you thrown. Not a moment have you mourned, not a whit of true lament, and for that you'll solitarily atone.
We'll convert you, we'll alert you to the law, let the clerk be out the charge.
The prisoner is accused of wantonly and flagrantly driving to the public danger.
A few ducks and geese. Birds thrive on danger.
And of gross impertinence to the police.
Nonsense! Tum twaddle is an old toad word of endearment.
The prisoner has the benefit of the doubt, but in this case there isn't any doubt, that is.
No doubt! Guilty!
Not a dubious report, no uncertainty is here. We've an accurate account of your travails. Not a dribble of excuse, no attempt to make amends. So we'll see that penal servitude prevails.
We'll convert you, we'll alert you to the law. Let the judge decide your fate.
20 years in the dungeon.
Years?
12 months for the theft. Quite mild. 3 years for the furious driving. Quite lenient. And 15 years for the tum twaddle. Those figures tote up to 19 years.
Make it an even 20, and the bookkeeping is so much simpler.
So be it. Case adjourned.
Guilty!
So, the basic story of The Wind and the Willows is this toad, he's got some kind of attitude problem, and he's been, you know, he's stealing cars, he's doing bad stuff, but he ends up running from the law and makes new friends, and, you know, all is forgiven in the end about friendship. Did you recognize the voice of the toad, by the way?
No, I did not. I did not recognize it at all.
That was Charles Nelson Reilly.
Really?
Of MASH fame, and that it had an all-star cast. So that was the last thing they ever did, and the studios ended up shutting down. Really? That was the last of Rankin and Bass. But not Jules Bass went on to do a bunch of other stuff. Let me see here. I don't know if everybody knows this, but he wrote the lyrics for many of the songs that he did in his specials. And he collaborated with a composer by the name of Maury Laws. And they stopped producing films in 1987, but Jules Bass went on to author a series of children's books based around the character called Herb the Vegetarian Dragon.
Oh, geez.
And Cooking with Herb. And then he also wrote fiction for adults, including a book called Headhunters, which was adapted into a film in 2011 featuring Selena Gomez. And but they changed the name to Monte Carlo. But okay. Yeah, that was like the last thing he worked on. And so, you know, he worked for a few years, and then, you know, he had this long, great career. One of the best things that besides the Christmas specials that they're known for is a movie based on the J.R.R. Tolkien book.
There we go.
The Hobbit. And I couldn't do the
You couldn't
show without showing part of The Hobbit, because I mean when this came out, this was huge.
Oh,
I mean,
it was.
I remember my friends really enjoyed this. And everybody, you know, it got everybody into reading these books again, you know, when I was in school. You know, and so everybody, you know, really loved this adaptation of Bilbo Baggins. I know that there's some people out there who criticize it now, but back at the time, people absolutely adored this movie, because I think it was the first adaptation of The Hobbit. It was.
Yeah. It was the first adaptation. You got to remember, in 77, you know, we had this film come out called, this little independent film called Star Wars came out. You know, and basically it started the ball rolling. The year before we had Logan's Run, it was a lot of science fiction.
And suddenly, this animated show movie comes out, and every kid in my eighth grade saw this film. We talked about this show all the like next month or so. It was all that anybody talked about. We did book reports were done on it at school. The teacher really was like not letting a lot of people do that. Somewhere in this house, I have the copy, the poster for this film.
Do you really? Yeah. That is awesome. Yeah. Oh my goodness.
Now we do have it because as some of you who do or do not know, Kara is a Lord of the Rings fanatic.
Oh, I didn't know that.
She has how many?
VHS 2 video.
Okay, so according to the wife, we have one VHS copy and two DVD copies of this Hobbit. So it followed the traditional Bass group thing. A lot of music involved in it. But I have to say, of their animation, this is perhaps their most sophisticated animation that they had ever done. You know? The storytelling was fairly faithful. You know, they didn't add new characters, you know, and they cut it down so that they could keep the story moving. They had the important things going on. And it was, I think it was a fairly good adaptation of The Hobbit.
I really enjoyed it. And yeah. I mean, I liked it a lot better than the three movies that came out.
I agree.
Overdrawn and overblown, and my daughter fell asleep during that. It's I think it was the second film. She was just like calmed down.
Yeah.
I think it went way far out of what the story really was.
Yeah.
But Romero Mueller, who wrote the teleplay for this version of The Hobbit, he won a Peabody Award.
Yeah.
And it was nominated for a Hugo Award for Best Dramatic Presentation, but. It lost to a little film. What was that little film?
I think it's Star Farmer or Blow Up Something Big. I can't remember the title.
Yeah.
You know?
And here's Mark today, you know, out at the Rise of the Resistance. You know, I have not been since they opened up that park.
Yeah.
But the Star Wars thing. And you would think, you know, I used to be like the most, I used to think I was the ultimate Star Wars fan, but now I realize I'm not, you know. back when I was a kid, I thought I was, but.
thank God when we were kids that the internet wasn't there, because it crushed a lot of our self-esteem.
It did, for sure. Let's see here. We got Orson Bean, the voice Villo, John Huston as Gandalf. Thank you very much.
I don't remember the John Huston part. I didn't know about Orson Bean. I don't know who Orson Bean is. I'll have to look him up.
But we'll play a clip from that that I got pulled out. So let me. Everybody knows the story. Bilbo Baggins, he's this reluctant hobbit who lives in a hole and ends up getting in an adventure that he didn't plan on getting into because Gandalf, his friend, the wizard, comes and says, "Hey, you got to go on an adventure with me."
Yep.
Here.
Don Messick was in this. So was Paul Frees.
There was a name change. What was the name change that ticked you off, Kara?
Kara, what was the name change that ticked you off?
They changed Saruman into Arrowman.
Oh, okay. I wonder why they did that.
And I have no idea.
It needs to be Saruman. I agree. I agree.
Yeah.
So let's go. Oh, we got more info here.
What do I got here?
Roddy McDowell played Samwise.
Ah. Not in The Hobbit. Not in The Hobbit.
Are you sure?
It was in The Return of the King. It had to have been Return of the King because Samwise does not appear in The Hobbit.
Oh, you know what? You're right.
Okay, I have to sort of correct my wife on that one. I get to do that one.
Okay, so let's get that clip up here.
Okay, it's in there somewhere.
Onward! Forward! To battle!
Scurvy dwarves!
Thieving dwarves!
Kill them! Chop them! Take their heads!
Kill the men! Kill the elves! Save the gold for ourselves!
Personally, I'd rather be back in Hobbiton.
Who's that old man?
Get out of the way!
Move, you old fool! Old fool.
Gandalf!
Halt! I would speak with the kings. Dread has come upon you all. An army of goblins with claim to the treasure comes from the north. Behold!
Yeah. It the funny thing about this was you didn't show a lot of the fight. You knew the fight happened, so they didn't have to draw a lot of that out, which was really great. The Hobbit just, you're right, it got people to read these books again.
Yep, it did.
You know, because if you think about it, if this Hobbit had not aired, people would have forgotten about Lord of the Rings and all of Tolkien's work. Because as time would gone on, because this was the time you had things like Stephen R. Donaldson's Thomas Covenant series coming out. You had a lot of other fantasy coming out that was inspired from them, but never mentioned about Tolkien. And this movie comes out and suddenly everybody's this book is back on the bestseller list.
Yeah. You know?
And that was a great thing. I think the Tolkien estate owes this studio a great debt of thanks, a gratitude for this. You know, it was really a good thing for the Tolkien estate.
Yes, you know? I totally agree. And like I said, besides the Christmas specials, this is probably the one that really put Rankin and Bass out there.
I think this was the height of their success, to be honest. I mean, there was a lot of other things that we talked about. Joe talked about another film. Kara talked about Return of the King, which came out in 1980, and the story behind that is rather interesting. But I think The Hobbit was the height of their success, other than the Christmas specials. You know? Yeah, she's listening to me in the other room. She hears me talking.
And Joe's right. You know, they did do The Last Unicorn also.
Yeah, but The Last Unicorn, as good as it was, just did not have the success of The Hobbit. You know? I mean,
probably because the story's darker.
Oh, much darker. Very dark. And yeah. the art is very much like a Bashki art from, like, you know, Wizards. There's a lot of that feel to it. And people just were not ready for that type of art when the Last Unicorn came out. It's now a cult classic. People talk about it as a great influence, but it just did not have the success that The Hobbit did, you know?
Right.
I was fortunate when Kara was about 6-7 months pregnant with Gwen. We were at New York Comic Con and we got a chance to meet the author of The Last Unicorn.
Really? That's pretty cool.
We bought the book and it's been signed to Gwen.
Oh, that's neat.
Yeah. So when she's older, she'll appreciate it. But yeah, I think the things that's interesting is all the things that they've done, because we have not even touched, okay, on the live action movies that they did. Okay.
Right.
There are some amusing live action films that I know I have seen and I didn't realize that they had done. Okay. Let's see here. I'm just going to run through some real quick ones.
Sounds good.
The Last Dinosaur.
Oh yeah.
King Kong Escapes, which was one of those, Gaiji, whatever, the Bushido Blade. I remember that one. The Bermuda Depths, which was a horror film, you know, when that time of the Bermuda Triangle is, you know, the source of all evil type of thing. They did some stuff that was, you know, that was very, become very much a cult classics nowadays. You know, they're almost like B films. The Ivory Ape, which I don't recall seeing, but, you know, once again, Bermuda Triangle and everything else.
I don't remember any of these, except the King Kong one's the only one that sounds familiar.
King Kong Escapes is Kong and faces Mecha Kong, okay? Bermuda Depths was a horror flick, which was actually pretty good. The Last Dinosaur was another one of those from I can't even pronounce the Japanese, but it was one of those productions. The Ivory Ape was also from Japan. The Bushido, same one. But I mean, basically, they did a lot of work with other ones. They did live action. Let's see, do they do animated shows or live action shows? I don't see any information. But the point is they did a lot of stuff.
Yeah, and you know? I mean, Rankin Bass did so much that we can only just touch the surface.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely.
Oh, you know? Oh, we got a frustrated senior here. Hold on.
She said I was a frustrated senior.
Yeah, oh my God. I have to agree with her on that one.
That's what's on the main one here. Frustrated senior.
I'm still laughing my ass off. That was absolutely incredible. Hey, I'm speechless right now. Okay. Rise of the Resistance. I'm speechless. Simple. Okay. Speechless, speechless, speechless. Okay. Brilliant.
When has that ever happened? You'd having nothing to say.
Speechless. Hey, I gotta take it when I can get it. This has just been an incredible ride. We just got off, headed over to Millennium Falcon now. But it was, I'm speechless. It wasn't open when I first came here. And I'm glad I got to get back. Thanks to an employee who works here, I got free tickets. So,
nice.
I was really, really happy to get here. I got free tickets for Universal next weekend. So,
so that explains why we're doing the show next Saturday without you.
Yeah,
that's right.
Hey, when you make sure you get a good picture of you in the cockpit of the Falcon.
Well, we're gonna try and find Chewbacca in a little bit.
Yeah.
But we gotta get over here to Millennial. So I just wanted to congratulate you guys for doing a great show. Joe was absolutely correct. It is well worth. I would have stood in line for 3 hours for this. Okay. You know, yeah, it was awesome. Guys, have a great finishing out of the show. Thank you for letting me pop in to say hi to you guys.
Absolutely, Mark.
Yeah, I'm going to go and kick some stormtroopers' asses, okay? Just so you know.
Don't worry, they'll miss you when they shoot. So.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.
Yeah.
So Mike had a thing about Odo Rene Auberjonois was the voice of the skull on Unicorn film. Okay.
Okay, I'll have to look that one up and see.
Yeah, you know? I miss him. I
was fortunate to have met him. You know.
I did not. I did. I missed.
So in the Unicorn, Mia Farrow, Alan Arkin, Jeff Bridges, Robert Klein, Angela Ansberry, Christopher Lee, Paul Frees, Don Messick, Rene Auberjonois, and a whole mess of others whose name I don't even recognize. It's quite the film, The Last Unicorn. I'll be honest, when it came out, okay, when did it come out?
I don't think it did well.
In 82. Okay, so think about 1982. All the films that it went up against, okay? You had, I think it was Empire Strikes Back came out. You had a whole mess of 80s comedies that were coming out, a whole mess of other stuff. It just sort of got lost in all of that shuffle, you know?
Yeah, and it wasn't really I don't think the kids would have liked it.
That's the problem. Back then, if it was animated, it was marketed as a kid's film.
Right.
And this was not a kid's film.
Right.
You know? So this would do well.
I think that's why it's gained such a cult following over the years now.
Yeah. I think if this film were to come out today, I think it would do much better because we are much more used to that type of art and storytelling.
I think that people have gotten, you know, it used to be people thought all animation was kid stuff. And over the years, I think people have finally gotten realized what an art form it really is.
Well, you can thank, and Rachel will tell you this also, you can thank anime for that. Okay.
Yeah.
They brought in anime. You brought in things like the start of the Speed Racers, the Robotech, Star Blazers. All of those 1980 shows came in and they weren't kid stuff. In Robotech, you had main characters dying off. You had discussions of sex, you know, and there wasn't the happy Disney film, you know, music in them. Okay.
Right.
You had real things happen and kids grew up on that. And as they grew up, they wanted the same thing. And that's why you saw in the 90s, the real transition of animation and everything else. So I think you can really thank anime for the change of animation from just for kids to now it's either the family or adults.
Right. Absolutely. You know? But, you know, and The Hobbit, too, you know, I mean, that appeals to all ages.
Yeah. So. Well, that's because of the, I mean, that's it's very Disney-fied. Let's not kid ourselves. It's got a lot of Disney feel to it. But it's also got a lot of the thing because you've got people dying. I mean, you got dwarves dying at the end there. They killed the dragon. I'm sorry, spoiler, you know. But you had, I mean, the whole aspects where they're caught, where the dwarves are caught in the spider's web. You know, that's a horrifying image if you think about it. Getting caught and wrapped up and still being aware of it. That's a horrifying thing. You know, when he meets Smeagol, you know.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, they could have made that darker, but it was still a pretty, you know, creepy, you know, scene. So, absolutely. Yeah, this did some really good stuff.
So, yeah. So, so that's it for our tribute to Jules Bass. You know, Rankin and Bass shows will be around forever, especially these, you know, the Christmas specials. And I hope everybody enjoyed the show. Jerome, thank you so much for your input.
No problem. Thank you.
And I hope everybody enjoyed the show. And thank you all for tuning in. Next week, Jerome's going to do the show since it would usually be Mark's turn, but for those who came in late, why don't you?
We're gonna do our best. We're gonna try to pull together stuff and do a Kevin Conroy homage because the man did some incredible work. The problem is I got to find the clips, and that's gonna be the tricky part. It always is for this show. So, but I think I can pull some off. May not be the ones that I want to do, but. Definitely, we're going to see what we can do. And we're talking about Kevin Conroy more than just Batman also. So we're going to see what we can do.
Thank you so much, everybody. I really appreciate all of you being here. And looking forward to next week's show, Jerome. And Mark will be at Universal. But please join us Saturday at 9 a.m. next week. For a special tribute to Kevin Conroy, Saturday Morning Cartoons. Thank you so much, you everybody, guys. For being here. And have a great night, or rest of your day.
Yeah, great night.
still running off of yesterday's classic television smack.
That's good.
But hold on a second. We're just going to sign off here. And as soon as I can find the right clip, guys.
Yeah, she's got it. It's somewhere in there.
It's somewhere. Okay.